And what does it mean translated, do you know?
No idea.
Okay. Does anybody know what Hennessian means translated? Silly person?
Dweeb.
You're giving away my whole thing for next verse. It's Johnson. Johnson, that's my name translated from Armenian. So, trivia, lots of little trivia. Okay, so without any further questions, let's go ahead to the presentation we're making today. We're going to be talking about pastoral-sized congregations. And pastoral-sized congregations have anywhere from 50 to 150 attending in church on Sunday, which makes this size congregation the typical Episcopal church. How many of you come from churches or have been to churches that have somewhere between 50 and 150 people? Okay. How many of smaller? Okay. And the rest of you of larger, right? Okay. So one of the things that you will learn if you hang around the Episcopal Church long enough is that the training for all Episcopal priests presumes that they will become rectors of this size congregation. That's what it presumes. And so most clergy know how to run this kind of congregation. Most clergy feel comfortable in this congregation. And the reason why the training is that way is because, number one, the majority of Episcopal churches are this size. And number two, seminary professors have no parochial experience. Most seminary professors, if they graduated from seminary and spent an assistantship in some place, then went off to college or a university, got their doctorates and became seminary professors. So they really don't have any experience on how these churches are organized. And they mostly came from that size congregation. So it's an assumption that congregations will be this size and will operate in this way. Therefore, it is an assumption that most lay people think that this is the way the church ought to be organized. Why? Because they grew up in those size congregations, they're trained by people and taught by people who were trained by people who believe that this is the only kind of congregation. And so it is what is considered the norm. And in fact, of the churches in the Episcopal Church, only 5% are larger than this size congregation. Okay? Which means that the Church of St. Philip is in the top 5% in terms of size. Largest? No. Largest church, we're talking 2,500 active members, average Sunday attendance of 1,300, 1,400. We're not that big yet. But give us one. We can get there. Okay, is that all clear so far? Remember, you can interrupt any time. Now, you may remember that in the family-sized congregation, the organization centered around a matriarch or a patriarch or both, men and women who have been there forever, and that the priests are kind of chaplains to the matriarchs and patriarchs. In a pastoral-sized congregation, that switches, and the center of activity is the priest. The priest replaces the matriarch and the patriarch in that congregation. And then there are different groups of people who typically have affinities. That is to say, the reason they come to church is because they're love worship, or the reason they come to church is because they're outreach people, or the reason they come to church is because they want education, things like that. And those affinity groups are ministered to by the pastor, and value, your value as a parishioner, is totally determined by your relationship with the pastor. And parenthetically, there's only one. You're not in a multiple pastor situation. So what happens to clergy in this kind of a congregation is that they are besieged by people wanting to get close to them. And this is both a good thing and a bad thing. It is a good thing because it allows, a priest can be in relationship with up to 150 people without being too confused. It takes a little time, but you can do it. It's a bad thing because people's motivations for cozying up to the clergy are very different. Some want power in the organization, and they see the way to get that is by having a relationship with the clergy. Some have the hots for the clergy. I'm serious, you read about it in the paper all the time, right? Some of them want to overthrow the clergy so they get close to them so they can get the dirt on them. Some of them are looking for a friend, which is very, very confusing to clergy because the clergy's operating under a pastoral relationship, which is professional and may not be a friend. I can remember somebody saying to me one time, "You're my best friend," and I thought, "You poor man." You know, surely someone likes you more than I do. I had to love him and did love him, and I had to work for his very good, which I did do, but I was doing that as a professional, and I certainly wasn't being his friend. So the roles here are both happy and confusing. The third thing is that membership in a congregation like this comes in circles. There's the inner circle, which is the pastor and those people who the pastor has anointed. Typically, those people that the pastor anoints are called, anybody guess? The vestry. Okay? And then there are the circles that have to do with fellowship, and then there's the wider worshiping membership circle. And people move in and out of relationship this way, depending upon who the rector is. Well, there's a rector change, there's all sorts of motion there. Different people drop out, new people come, lots of stuff happens, okay? And the other thing that happens is in this kind of a congregation is that you get to be on the vestry because you've gone up through the chairs. Does everybody know what I mean when I say that? Okay, it's a little bit like charities. Okay, if you want to do charities and start out and help with a charity, you might get the American Cancer Association to collect on your block and things like that. But if you really achieve the pinnacle of charity success, you get to run the AIDS ball. There's a hierarchy. Okay? And the same thing is true in congregations. There's the things that you do. If you hang around long enough, they may ask you to be an usher or something like that, and eventually maybe ask you to teach church school, and eventually they may ask you to lead a commission or do a special outreach program or a special collection or whatever. And eventually you get known well enough so that you get elected onto the vestry. And your rise to the vestry has nothing to do with whether or not you ought to be in a vestry. It has to do with the fact that you have demonstrated leadership. This is good and bad. As good points as bad points, like everything in every system. Everybody clear so far? Questions? Okay, this should be the easiest one because I'm talking to the choir here. You all understand this. It is the assumption, parenthetically, in the DNA of St. Philip's, it is the assumption that this is a pastor-sized congregation. And that's the way we are currently organized, and that's the way we currently are trying to proceed. Okay, so what are some of the dynamics? Okay.